We hope you're well. We hope that one, you who has just returned from work, you've done so safely. Those that are still on duty, we wish you good luck and blessings. We, on the checkpoint today, we want to talk about teachers' welfare and its impact on the entire education sector in Uganda. And on the set tonight, if you remember very well, the second term, academic term for students in high school and primary school began early last week on Monday. And on the set today, I have been joined by Mugaiga Aaron. He's the General Secretary, Uganda Professional Science Teachers Union. I also have Mwamula Juma. He's also the Secretary General, Uganda Private Teachers Union, and Executive Board Member of the National Organization of Trade Unions and Workers' Councillor in Wakiso District. I think he understands unions and workers' rights like the back of his hand. Aaron and Juma, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Nicholas.
Aaron, I'm going to begin with you. When the school term opened last week, there has been a bit of upheaval within science teachers. Many schools across the country, science teachers have been hesitant going to class, arguing that their promised salary enhancement by government of Uganda has not yet been realized. And thus, as a reason, they cannot go to class. Is this just the only reason as to why you've not been able to report back to your classes, to your duty station, which is the class, or are there other concerns that as science teachers you are raising that governments needs to hear?
Yeah, thank you very much, our host tonight. Good evening, our dear viewers and listeners. My name is Mugaiga Aaron, General Secretary, Uganda Professional Science Teachers Union. And I will start straight to your question, that is it the only reason? Salary enhancement is not the only reason. We presented a document entailing 11 reasons to why we decided to go for industrial action. And one of them is the continued marginalization and discrimination of the scientists in education sector in as far as salary enhancement is concerned. But it was the major reason out of the 11 we presented. Others are to do with our general welfare while at school. Others are to do with the protection of science teachers while in the laboratories. You will notice that science teachers have got very many risks while they're in the laboratories. They interact with dangerous chemicals and acids, and a number of them actually have fallen victims of these. Some have become lame, they have been burned by acids. But you notice that in most cases, some of these teachers are not compensated. Some actually lose lives. Some even are affected, the neural system is affected. You find somebody cannot speak well anymore, cannot even walk well. Recently, we showed some teachers who were actually affected by chemicals and acids. And they became lame. They can no longer now work for their families. And the unfortunate bit of it is that when some of these teachers suffer these laboratory accidents, actually, when they discover that they can no longer serve the way they used to do, they terminate their services. Now, when they terminate their services, sometimes they don't give them compensation. Or when they try, they give less. Now, this is somebody who has been serving and is now affected by the chemicals. gets an accident on the job. Now you release them to go home. They can't take care of their families.
Is this a case for only private teachers or also teachers in government schools? Because I understand government has a full policy on workman's compensation.
Actually, I am referring to government employees. What I'm talking about is not something from far. I'm talking about realities. Well, those policies may be there, but in most cases, one, people are not sensitized about these policies. Two, even our supervisors sometimes do not follow them. So you find that this teacher has been serving quite well.
But if a teacher is not aware of what their rights are, of what the human resource, the national human resource manual entails, what workman's compensation is, if they are not aware of that, then how can we trust what kind of knowledge they impart in our children?
But you see, this is somebody like the one we presented to media recently. Somebody has already been affected. You know, an accident is an accident. Even a person can no longer comprehend anything. So they can't even know which policy you may actually apply to them. So we'd expect things to be straightforward. Let there be a compensation policy, these science teachers. And many people actually do not believe that science teachers actually fall into these laboratory accidents. When we discovered recently, when it became common in the media, that actually people don't understand this. They think teaching is about getting choke and going to class
and going to
and
class.
Deliver.
Yeah.
But science teachers go through a lot of risks, and many have actually suffered these accidents become them. And so it is they are among the many things. Another issue related to that is science teachers, you know, for them to get specimen and the thing they use to teach practicals, they have to run around in the bushes, they have to go to rivers and lakes, look for amphibians, look for reptiles, to bring to class and deliver to the
animals. So generally you're talking about the working conditions.
Yes.
But now I want you to specifically on salary enhancement.
Yes.
What would trigger a teacher who probably, I assume, is a parent to go on an industrial action, yet government has committed itself that all scientists in Uganda, their salaries are going to be enhanced. That includes science teachers at the expense of fairness, at the expense of other Ugandans that are serving in the same profession. So I'm finding trouble understanding what your industrial action is about, yet you have arts teachers that are in class teaching without any commitment from government. You have commitment from government that your salaries are going to be enhanced. So what pushes you into industrial action?
You see, there is one thing you need to understand. There is making a commitment, but when that commitment cannot be trusted, that is one. Number two,
how can you not trust a government commitment? Because once government gives you its word, it's as good as taking an arm and a leg to the bank.
We may not have any issue with government, but you know, by the time we come out to go for industrial action, just to know we have gone through a lot. If I'm to give you some little bit of background. You are talking about arts teachers. I will come to that. Now, in 2018, 2019, government came up with a policy to enhance salaries. And they enhanced salaries for all scientists. Now, scientists fall into different departments of government. Now, in the education sector, we have scientists, and those are the science teachers and the lecturers that teach in science in NTCs. And we have also the BIT and NIC instructors. All those are the scientists we are talking about. Now, government had earmarked resources to enhance salaries for all these categories. But when it came to the funds for the scientists in the education sector, that fund to the tune of 98 billion was diverted. and science teachers never received it as enhancement because it was supposed to take them 2.2 million like other scientists in other sectors other than medical. And diploma was supposed to go to 1.2. But the funds meant for scientists in education sector was diverted. But because the government had actually was in the process of enhancing this salary, they went ahead and paid science teachers for 2 months, others 3 months. Now later, they withdrew the payment. And the unfortunate bit is that they forced science teachers to pay to pay back what they had given them 3 months. Now this meant...
What period is this that you're talking about?
2018, 2019. Mm-hmm. Now because these science teachers...
So when at what point does government force science teachers to pay back to pay back the money that had been already dished out to them?
Auntie, you know, after they had paid this money, they forced science teachers to bring it back, but they had used it earlier, so they had to use their salaries. So it meant that most of them had to go another 3 months without payment. And I was one of them, actually.
That was affected.
That. Yes, I was affected. So we had to ask, and they told us that the reason we are not scientists, that science teachers are not scientists. And this really had
that
to...
That science teachers are not scientists.
Yes. So we felt very bad, actually. Majority of the science teachers across the country became very angry of this decision because it meant that they have to go another 3 months without payment. Imagine you work from day one to the 30th day of the month, no payment, and yet you have to start another month. So we had to start engaging government. And we felt, you know, you cannot say, me, a biology teacher, I'm not a scientist, and yet you want this doctor upcoming to go through my hands. How can a goat produce a rabbit? That's not possible.
But how was that possible? Yet the president was very categorical in enhancing salaries for scientists across the board. He was very categorical about science teachers.
And
he
that's... Said,
yes, government needs to enhance salaries of all public servants, but first, science teachers in primary and secondary school.
And you see, that's where we find a problem. President directs, and funds are provided by government, but some people, somewhere, the technical people, they connive, some in education sector, others public service and finance. They connive and divert this money without even the knowledge of the top people we believe. So, but if you could allow me first to finish this, because what happened in 2018 is still fresh in our minds. Now, what triggered us to go for industrial action on the line of salary enhancement was that the policy that government reapproved and affirmed on 24th of August last year to enhance salaries for all scientists. Now, funds were provided, 400 billion, in the coming financial year in this budget process.
Yes.
And they distributed this fund to all sectors. And they gave the scientists in the education sector 139 billion. Now, when they gave us 139 billion, the processes continued. We learned in early April that this fund for science teachers has also been diverted. And actually, we confirmed in the meeting we had with Minister of Finance, Minister of Public Service, and Minister of Education on the 6th of this month. They told us there is no money for science teachers. And this was very bad, and the president was very clear, categorical, and even directed, if you recall on 10th October last year, in the Teachers' Day, that was celebrated, supposed to be celebrated on the 5th, but it was celebrated on 10th. He was very clear. And even directed Minister of Public Service in the presence of everybody. And the funds were provided. But we find these funds are being diverted. That's where we find the problem, and we said we cannot take this anymore.
Thank you very much. Yes. I'm going to get back to you, but first let me bring in Juma here. Juma, one, what is going on in the education sector? The salary disparity. How, as Aaron struggles for his life, he has said he's one of those that have actually missed out salary for 3 years, for three months. But I want to understand from you as an arts teacher, as an arts teacher, What is the impact of this selective salary enhancement on you? Because the policy is clear that we are going to have selective salary enhancement, albeit the challenges that Aaron and his people are facing. But what exactly is the impact of that particular policy on you, the arts teacher?
Thank you, Nicholas. Again, good evening, our viewers out there. Juma Mwamura from Uganda Private Teachers Union. True, you're right. My area of speciality is arts. I have history and geography.
Are you needed anyway, like the president?
I am needed. Mm. I am a teacher. I am qualified. I am even doing further improvement, and I hope I will continue serving as a teacher. So I have a pride to that. Mm. First, I really want to sympathize with my comrades from Science Professional Workers Union. Mm. They have struggled to put forth their voice about what they are aspiring to have. Mm. And that clearly communicate to the long-time cry that has always been existing. Mm. As teachers, generally, our welfare has been very miserable. Mm. In fact, it has been so miserable that even outside in the public, we now have a public image about the appearance of a teacher. Mm. I want to tell you, if you dared to walk around the streets of Kampala, people can be able to kind of, there are insinuations that are made.
That one must be a teacher.
Somebody would outrightly tell you, boda guy would outrightly tell you, master, teacher, mkutwali. So is the tax stunts, those guys. But that is simply because of the way we have portrayed the appearances of our teacher. And I must say that that has not been a good appearance. It has not been a good picture. It is actually more of mockery. That is the picture of the status of the teacher of Uganda. And we are saying there is a need for change. There is an immediate need for change. So we need to see a situation where we have guarantee of the environment under which a teacher serves. We want to see a guarantee to the improvement of what a teacher takes away after his work. Because then that gives the ultimate motivation that can push this person to really do his best, and therefore we get the better education that we have. Maybe where I have some kind of reservation is in the particular voices where a few people believe that if we have to address the issues of teachers, we need to get them by clicks. But I also needed to make a revelation that particularly for workers in government generally, the biggest lot of workers are teachers, the biggest professional lot. Mm. Like the government employees, lawyers, health workers, teachers, and so on.
The biggest lot are teachers.
Mm. And therefore, at that level, it gives us an opportunity. If we really can mass a single voice, it gives us an opportunity to do collective bargaining, to ride on the advantage of our numbers and influence. But now what we are seeing are those kind of divided voices where each sect seem to think that they need to speak for themselves. And that is something that we really need to swallow within ourselves and embrace unity, embrace brotherhood, because what relates to us all is the same. On two occasions, my colleague has just mentioned about them. The first was when we were having celebration for International Teachers Day, and the very last one is this, when we had the Labor Day. Mm-hmm. The president was making a justification for science teachers, and he does an illustration of a case that was happening at Soroti Flying School, where he was insisting that, you see, there are these people who are fighting for status. A human resource insisting, me as a human resource who manages this pilot, why do I have to earn less than the pilot?
Mm. But there are so many human resource managers on the street.
I think that was not a rightful comparison. Mm. And unfortunately, there are very few minds, there are very few heads that can speak straight to the president, including indicating to him that in some instances there can be mistakes. Mm. As a person, I observe his push as a fundamental mistake. That push of imagining that we are going to have one slot of people doing exactly the same thing, treated very distinctly from the others, is a fundamental slot. Because what is going to happen so that we shall see the colleagues of Mr. Mgaiga and others really being motivated, which is the prayer for all of us. Mm. But eventually, it is going to raise a question mark to whoever think has not been part of that. And what we will see, just like Mr. Mgaiga today is on strike because they are yearning for increment. The others who also think that they are making a contribution to education will also go on a sit down. And so eventually we'll start seeing the education sector as if it is a war field, one group after the other going into strike. What does that translate into? It can translate into a collapse of public education system. And now when the public education system collapses, perhaps the leverage would be the private education sector. But you and me know that the investment in private education sector so far is not big enough to accommodate every child, a Ugandan child. The other thing is that even the little that is existing is expensive. Mm. Even when we are teachers who want to have the best, we are also parents. For example, as Mamla Juma, I am purely working for Uganda Private Teachers Union as a full-time officer, so that is where I earn my bread. But any of my contemporaries who are at school, whatever they earn, cannot sustain about 3 children in any prominent private school around Kampala here. You see that? Mm. So while we think that we need to kill the public sector, we will not afford the private sector. And so eventually what we will see is a class of a few people who are advantaged, including taking their children outside of Uganda, having education for their families and children, and then the rest of us who cannot afford to pay the cost raised by that confusion, having ours stunted at home. And so a class divide of those who are elite, those who are educated, and those who are not educated. That is why we are saying that while we push for enhancement of welfare for teachers, it should be an exclusive approach. Mm.
Inclusive.
Sorry, it should be an inclusive approach. It should be for everybody. It should be all embracing. Mm. As much as we want the science teacher, so do we need the English, the fine art, and every other person who is contributing to the curriculum of the school. So that is the thing. The other thing that maybe my brother Aaron and others might need to know and perhaps concentrate on is, as we speak now, we do not have a clear definition of what is science in education, in teaching. When the president was addressing us on the last International Teachers Day, he said that his directive or his decree is going to start from senior secondary schools. That therefore means that every teacher in primary is not part of that arrangement. But maybe you and me know that on the curriculum of primary, there is a subject called science. Mm. Even my basic imagination is that this science as a concept does not just come and start from secondary. It has a background.
Yes,
It has a foundation from which it is springing up to where now it comes to make
probably
a fair
the biology
shape.
That Aaron teaches.
Uh-huh. If we think that we are going to act high-handedly and be insensitive to this person who is laying the foundation, we are definitely losing out. We are even missing. Mm. Because then if that person is demotivated, what he or she might do could have adverse impact to the efforts that we think we shall be investing in later on.
I'm going to come back to you, Juma. Mm. Juma raises very pertinent points. Mm. He says their thought was that the cry for salary enhancement for teachers should be collective bargaining. I remember very well when this was raised, somehow science teachers seem to be going into the corner and saying, wait a minute, perhaps the president is right. Perhaps the best alternative would be to grab whatever little you can grab from government and run away with that. Today, you've been boxed in a similar corner where government itself is now boxing you where the president had boxed the arts teachers. And it is saying, no, you're not actually science, you're not actually scientists. No, okay? Two is you as a teacher. I do not in your, don't you think you were strategically wrong to think that you'll be able to go it alone and achieve your goal? Two is, where is the principle of fairness for you as a teacher? Okay?
Now, anyway, allow me respond to those three issues, but let me start with this very one. My brother and friend, Mwamura Juma, says that there is no clear definition of who is a scientist. Mm. And I just want to possibly remind him and possibly educate those who may be having that kind of thinking, that in Uganda there is a clear definition of who is a scientist. And a scientist is that person who has undertaken a course in science or in one of the science disciplines at university, at minimum of a diploma. There is no science at the certificate.
But you were aware, wait, for example. On that very point, you are aware, for example, that there are primary teachers that are degree holders.
And that's so where I'm coming.
Are they disqualified as
That's
as
where
scientists?
I'm coming. Let me first clear on the issue of primary. You see, this is where you people mix things and you confuse a very clear policy. You know, in primary, per the definition I already mentioned, in primary, actually the disciplines I'm talking about, one of the disciplines can be chemistry, can be physics, or physical science, biological science, and it all those other disciplines. Yes, but these are the disciplines which are not at primary level.
They don't number teach two, mathematics at primary
level. Wait, I am coming for you. You know science. Maybe I will need to start from the categorization. There is what we call STEM. Now, we have what we call science. This is where we have natural sciences, those chemistry, physics, biology. Then we have technology. Technology, that's where we have those subjects that fall in that category, like ICT, computer science, and all others. Then we have engineering. That's where we have disciplines like electrical engineering, building, construction, and all those that actually are offered in the tertiary institutions. And then mathematics. Naturally, mathematics is not a science. It falls in its own category as mathematics. But maybe what I needed to also
I'm going to ask you to hold your point right there, and we go for a very short break.
Okay.
Let's break.
What a wonderful time to be a business person. Learn how to make money, learn what the authorities are saying, that is from